In this church, all are welcome, young and old, members and visitors, sinners and saints. We welcome those who are lost and those who are found. For through God's abundant love, we are all invited to the place of honor at the Lord's table. Let us satisfy our thirst to feel God's love here and now as we welcome the presence of God together with the call to worship. Let us rejoice, for the Lord has made a covenant with all people. Know the word of the Lord, for they walk in the light of your presence.
You are the glory of our strength, and by your favor our life is exalted.
We only need look around to be persuaded that God's love is established forever. The Lord is as constant as the stars in the heavens.
Truly the Lord is our Lord.
Thank you. to be an expression of our heart's deep longing to come closer to the one who created us, so that we may become better human beings. Let us join together in the prayer of renewal, so that we may be cleansed of sin and restored in spirit. Lord God,
as we pray, let your name be hallowed, not my name, let your kingdom come, not my kingdom. Your will be done, not my will. Let us live in peace with you, with humanity and with ourselves, and deliver us from fear. Amen.
Lord, you showed us the way. All of the commandments, all of the Bible, can be held on two commandments. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and to love your neighbors yourself. If you strive for that, then you are saved. You are forgiven. We are loved. And through Amen.
Thank you.
This morning's scripture lesson is Genesis, chapter 22, verses 1 through 14. Please listen to the word of God. After these things, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham," and he said, "Here I am." He said, "Take your son, your only son Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I shall show you." So Abraham rose early in the morning, saddled his donkey, and took two of his young men with him, and his son Isaac. He cut the wood for the burnt offering, and set out, and went to the place in the distance that God had shown him. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place far away. Then Abraham said to his young men, "Stay here with the donkey. The boy and I will go over there. We will worship, and then they will come back to you." Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. So the two of them walked on together. Isaac said to his father, Abraham, Father. And he said, Here I am, my son. He said, The fire and the wood are here, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering? Abraham said, God himself will provide the lamb for a burnt offering. So the two of them walked on together. When they came to the place that God had shown him, Abraham built an altar there and laid the wood in order. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then Abraham reached out his hand and took the knife to kill his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham. And he said, Here I am. He said, Do not lay your hand on the boy or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. And Abraham looked up and saw a ram caught in the thicket by its horns. And Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, The Lord will provide. And it is said to this day, on the mount of the Lord, it shall be provided. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Lord God, sometimes it feels that you're testing us. But we know that you will provide answers. So as we approach your word, we search for those answers. Help us to find the right and the only one. All right. So this text is actually very. And it's I could have done something on the 4th of July, but talking about our country and politics right now, I thought it'd be easier to talk about Abraham sacrificing his son to God. So, it's a difficult text. It's a very difficult text. Some preachers will exalt this text as the ultimate expression of faith and love for God and God's mercy. Some preachers actually refuse to preach on this text and say that it is an unreasonable God. This text has been pointed by atheists to show the barbarity of the Abrahamic religions, and it has been revered by scholars to show the complexity of Scripture. So, there's a lot of ways to look at it. What are we doing? Well, it's a text that must be interpreted. You can't just read this story on face value. You can't just look at it in black and white. Otherwise, you can't preach it. It doesn't make sense. And in fact, the text encourages us to grapple. It encourages us to interpret, to imagine, to even argue and ask questions. The overarching question in this text is the morality. Is Abraham doing the right thing by saying he will sacrifice his son because God asked him? Is that the test? In our imaginations, we're almost forced to imagine a conversation between Abraham and Isaac as they're walking up. There's just that little hint of, hey, Father, we have the fire, we have the knife, but where's the lamb? That's it. But we know there had to be more. So we create that conversation in our minds. And it makes us ask all sorts of questions about this text. It's purposely ambiguous. This story would have has a whole different meaning if you think Isaac is 5 years old, or if Isaac is 25 years old. And he's 25 years old, David. This is a test of Isaac's faith. So, how do we interpret this? What do we do? Well, there are many different interpretations. One is the sort of most common, that this is the ultimate act of faith. God requires everything from us. Abraham is willing to give up everything. His one son who he's been waiting for 100 years, and he's willing to give that son to God. And because he's willing to give that son to God, he proves his faith, and he passes the test, and God is merciful and just and provides a way out. And this is the typical interpretation, but even it doesn't, even this has questions. For example, what does it mean that Abraham had faith? Was Abraham's faith that God would provide a lamb or a goat, and so we wouldn't have to sacrifice Isaac? Or was God's faith that even sacrificing might be the right thing to do? This is even more complicated when we try to amplify this example as the foreshadowing of Jesus. Jesus, the Son of God, died on the cross. And this is echoed in Paul, because Paul talks about how this is the perfect example of faith. But actually, they're very different stories. Because whereas Abraham was preparing to sacrifice Isaac, Jesus was actually sacrificed. Whereas Abraham was going to kill for his faith, Jesus was killed for his faith. Whereas Abraham sacrifices his son for God, God sacrifices Jesus for us. So they're hard to complete. And it gets even more complicated when we look at the aftermath of what happened. That you have this story, and so much goes on after. We know that Abraham is not necessarily the most perfect guy in the world. We see that he is willing to lie and give his wife to somebody else twice in order to save his own skin. We see him willing to abandon his mistress and her child, exiling them to almost certain death in the desert. And then we see him willing to sacrifice his son. So he's a deeply flawed character. And then it forces us to ask the question, well, what is going on here? Is this maybe some form of ancient child abuse? It almost sounds like a blasphemous question. But believe it or not, this is not a new moral interpretation. This is actually something that the rabbis asked 2,000 years ago when they were interpreting the scripture. They noticed that, for example, right after this story, it talks about Sarah dying. They noticed that right after this story, Abraham pretty much is done. He doesn't have any more adventures. He doesn't have any more conversations with God. He remarries, true. But then when he dies, he is buried next to Sarah. As almost a way of saying, I'm sorry. And then look at what happens to Isaac, the poet of this game. Well, Isaac never talks to his father again. In fact, when he gets buried, it says he was buried in the tent of Sarah, not in the tent of Abraham. Isaac is never has a real conversation with God or any adventures. In fact, some of the rabbis even theorized that maybe he was developmentally delayed or permanently scarred by this event because he never leaves his homeland. He has to have Abraham go and get him a wife. The only role he really plays is, even though he's one of the patriarchs, he's kind of a developed character. The only real role he plays is as at the end, he's an old blind man who's manipulated by his wife and tricked by his children. It's a really horrible story. And then we take this story and we say, yes, and we're going to use this as the example that paves the way to our story about Jesus being crucified. But this is a horrible story. But it doesn't mean we worship a horrible God. Because it's a story that requires interpretation. It needs to be seen in more than one dimension. It's more than just this perfect act of faith. From a historical point of view, a lot of people have said this is actually a renunciation of human sacrifice. Because this was a time when people really were sacrificing their children to God. And God tells Abraham, don't do it. Stay here. Another interpretation of this story is that maybe the test of faith was a little bit different. Maybe Abraham's test was to actually refuse God's request or argue with God, as he argued for the salvation of Sodom and Gomorrah. Maybe Abraham was supposed to know already that God is a loving and merciful God, and he shouldn't ask this question. And in that case, Abraham failed the test of faith. And yet, God was merciful and loved him anyway. Or, another interpretation is that maybe Abraham was testing God. Maybe Abraham knew God is a loving and merciful God, and he would never ask me to do this. And so I'm only going to raise my son in the way of Yahweh if he ends up sparing him. And Abraham was just waiting for that lamb to die, the goat to come out of the bushes. And Abraham was right. God told him to stay his ear. In that case, God has the test. So, this story is about sacrifice, about love, about God, about faith. In many ways, to me, this story is, no matter how you look at it, it's about morality. It's about what are we willing to do for the greater good. In philosophy, that's called utilitarianism. The pop culture way to say it is the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few. That we might need to sacrifice one person to save a bunch of people. And that's what I think Abraham in some ways thought he might be doing. And there's, but that doesn't always work the way we want. So, for example, someone said, hey, would you kill Hitler in order to save the Jews from the Holocaust? Of course! Until you realize that's the exact same argument that Hitler used to kill the Jews in order to help the German people. It's a utilitarian argument saying that we can do sacrifice one person to save someone else, or sacrifice one thing for the greater good. But here's the difference, and this is why this all comes down, and this is why I don't think this story quite foreshadows Jesus in the way that we always think. Because Abraham was willing to kill for God. But I don't know if he was willing to put his own life on the line. We often talk about the great sacrifice of Abraham. What about the great sacrifice of Isaac? Jesus put his own oath on. And in that utilitarian problem, let's say the question is, and the famous question is, there's a train coming and it's going to crash and kill a bunch of people, or you can pull the switch and it will only run over one person. What do you do? Well, the answer is, well, you pull the switch, but then you feel bad about killing one person. You deliberately kill that person. One of the answers to that question is, no, it's if you are willing to step in the way of that train, if you are willing to sacrifice yourself, then it solves the problem. Then it's about sacrificing, for the greater good. You can't make someone else do the sacrifice. You have to. And that's where the crucifixion teaches us this ultimate moral lesson. It takes the story of Abraham and kind of flips it on its head and moves it one step further. It's not about killing in the name of God, it's about dying. It's not about fighting, it's about loving. And if we do that, then we really will pass the test.
The summer season is a time of leisure. We relax in the warmth of the sun and go on vacations. But as we spend on family and fun, let us not forget that there is work to be done. There is no rest for the poor and the needy. God calls us to always work for God's kingdom.
Thank you.
blessing for God's people with the unison prayer of dedication.
Welcome, Holy Mother, bless these gifts with your Spirit. Transform these gifts into the law that the world needs. May these gifts may be welcomed in the new world of love. Amen.
Please be seated.
As we begin our service of communion, let us remember that there are no fences around him. Jesus welcomed everyone, the poor, the rich, the old, the young, Greek, Jew, slave, and free. Nothing can tie up, nothing can bind God's great love. So as we turn to our service, lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks and praise to God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise to God.
Please join me in the great prayer of thanksgiving as we say,
compassionate God, you are the voice behind the word.
Saying, Baruch Atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam, And he broke it. And he said, "This is the bread of life, my body broken for you. Take, eat, and remember me." Same evening, after the meal had concluded, Jesus poured the juice. And again, he gave thanks, and he blessed it in the traditional way, saying, "Baruch atah Melech Ha'olam, bori kri avatha." And he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, poured out it and sealed in my blood. When you drink it, drink all of it, and remember me. Come, friends, the table is prepared, all is ready."
Thank you.
we may have come to this place as individuals, tossed by the winds of fate, but through our worship and this holy sacrament, we have come together, not only in communion with our brothers and sisters, but with the one God of all peoples and nations. Let us celebrate this relationship with the prayer after communion. Lord God,
alone we are in the depths of darkness, but with you our path is clear. Lord God, alone we are lost and wandering, but with you we are truly alone. Lord God, alone we wander in the rivers of righteousness and reputation, but with you we are truly now. Thank you, O Lord, for this community and this union. May we continue to drink from your cup of blessing and share your exciting welcome with the world. Amen.
Please go ahead and first next to you, your own head, your benediction here.